Modern man suffers from a kind of poverty of the spirit.
Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a man of wealth.
We're more than handicapped without these laws. We're crippled.
I've been around emotional.
We have a right. So right on the bus.
We didn't land on Plymouth Rock. Plymouth Rock landed
Jesus
on us.
Jesus Christ.
As countless social movements took to the streets, nearly half a million people with disabilities were trapped in institutions, unable to express themselves, unable to protest, unable to live in society. For tens of millions living outside of institutions, the lack of access and social acceptance reinforced the inability to live in the community. People with disabilities were stigmatized with pity and fear. They were considered socially upsetting individuals of less worth. They were them. From this atmosphere, a philosophy of independent living developed, which Lex Fridin described as participating in day-to-day life, making decisions that lead to self-determination. For disabled people, that implies living in the community, away from custodial institutions, responsible for one's own affairs. While America was changing the way it viewed itself, three men of different backgrounds took a stand for independent living and disability rights. Ed Roberts, an aspiring baseball star, Wade Blank, a minister from Ohio, and Justin Dart, a wealthy business executive. These men joined an army of disability advocates to change society forever, taking a stand while sitting down. Ed Roberts, a vibrant boy with contracted polio and was paralyzed from the neck down, able to move only one finger. He became what many considered the father of independent living.
Some doctor had told Ed's mother that she should hope that he would die because he'd never be more than an artichoke.
A high school honor student, Ed attended community college and was accepted to Cal Berkeley. The Department of Rehabilitation rejected his request for tuition assistance, claiming him to be unemployable. Ed took his first stand while in an iron lung, went to the media, and won the needed assistance.
The reason he became a pioneer was not because he was nice, not because he was friendly, but because he challenged, and it was in his spirit and it was in his nature to challenge everything, challenge everybody.
Ed was the first Cal student with a severe disability. The only accommodating housing was an unused wing of the Cal Hospital. Other students with disabilities followed Ed's path and together formed the Rolling Quads, an advocacy group which inspired the first independent living center in 1972.
He could articulate the vision, he was a leader, he was an example, and he was willing to put in the work.
In 1975, Governor Jerry Brown appointed Ed to director of the Department of Voc Rehab, the same department that had previously denied him services, and opened 9 new independent living centers. Ed won an epic battle against the federal government to fund these centers.
He broke incredible ground in a whole bunch of different areas. Really, wherever he went, he had an amazing impact on people.
His genius was like a genius of the heart. There was a power there that you just can't, you almost can't talk about.
And it'd say, so today I'm here as an artichoke. And it'd say, I'm prickly on the outside, but I have a big heart on the inside.
Ed Roberts led the inspirational charge for thousands of advocates to create 400 independent living centers in the United States and co-founded the World Institute on Disability in 1982. That facilitated international reform for countless millions of people in their struggle for human rights.
The lunatic is on the grass. The lunatic is on the grass.
Wade had come out from Kent State, where he had been shocked, horrified by the killing of the students, and he'd been a minister at Kent State. And to recover, he took a job as an activities director at Heritage House, which was an absurd job in a way, but obviously was prophetic for his life, because he never left that mission.
He first started Atlantis Community after working in a nursing home and seeing how people with disabilities are warehoused there and told when to get up and what to do for the day. Wade created Atlantis. It was the first home health agency in the state of Colorado.
As Wade Link took a stand for accessible public transit in Denver, he was confronted by the disability community's cry of nothing about us without us. Wade not only had to fight the society's inability to adapt, he also had to fight for the support of the greater disability community.
He had this way of talking to people that made them listen, and they made them like him, made them believe him. He was an enchanting person, he really was.
Like Reverend King, Wade involved the poorest of the community and attacked the grossest social institutions that enslaved them. In 1983, he co-founded American Disabled for Accessible Public Transit, ADAPT, which was an organization with the power to fundamentally change these situations through protest and civil disobedience.
He had this real belief in the evolution of justice over time, over history. He really did. He really believed in the triumph of justice.
He was a brilliant, unbelievable theorist. He was a Buddha in theory. He was enlightened. He understood exactly how things would go, to the point that he said he was had become gold.
Justin Dart once remarked that, "I was never sure in my heart if I was on the right side of the bars, but I knew Wade was." In 1967, Justin Dart went to Saigon and visited an institution for children with disabilities, a visit he later recalled as a branding iron burning onto my soul that inspired his stand for the rights of people with disabilities.
He touched so many lives in a positive way, and he was so easy in doing it that people don't realize a lot of things that he's done.
Returning to Texas in 1974, he entered the world of disability rights, where his journey to craft America's last civil rights bill began. By 1985, the principles of an American with Disabilities Act were envisioned through his experience of shaping disability policy for Texas.
It was all about work, and it was all about empowerment, and it was all about thinking the long term and changing people's attitudes.
I remember when we were trying to get the ADA through the Congress. He took up his own time and traveled around America taking testimony to take it back to the Congress to show them the dilemma that people with disabilities are facing across America.
The passage of the ADA incorporated an immense political struggle that directly affected 42 million Americans living with disabilities and their loved ones.
We couldn't get Dukakis to say he'd sign the ADA to save his life. Whereas Bush made a big deal about, yes, he would sign it.
It was really it shows you a great mix of the conservative, progressive sort of thing that came together around an issue, which was disability rights.
Justin Dart passed away 12 years later, but his message lives on. It was, as every speech he ever delivered, the words of a fighter, "Lead on, I love you."
I guess you would say he's the type that can walk in crowds and hold his moral virtue and talk with kings, yet not lose that common touch.
How many roads must a man walk down before you call him a man?
I confluence of these movements, the anti-war movement, the civil rights movement, the vote for women movement, the consumerism movement. People with disabilities, part of these communities, part of America. People come to me and say, golly, what you guys did was just brilliant. And I'm not impressed by that. I mean, if it hadn't been me, if it hadn't been Justin, if it hadn't, it would have been somebody else, because it was a natural thing to happen.
Yes, and how many years can a mountain exist before it is washed to the sea? Yes, and how many years can some people exist before they're allowed to be free?